Welcome on back, everybody, to the MSI Dragon Battle. We're finally getting into the semifinals match. It's going to be Scary Faces facing up against Team Alternate Attacks. Real quick update on round one, though. As I was looking at it earlier, we had a couple of upsets. First of all, Team Alternate were facing up against 4ASC, ended up winning that to be here in the semifinals up against Scary Faces. And then on the other side, we're going to follow basically unknown. They are going to battle up against Zero Respect, a French team who beat the Balkan Bears Corleone. So those are your matches for the rest of the night. Let's get into our first game of the day. We'll just put it like that for now. Anyway, our first semifinal today is what I should say. Sorry, our studio broke earlier, so things have been a little bit wonky ever since. But Scary Faces, this team has actually been pretty damn impressive. If you guys don't know who Scary Faces is, they are an up-and-coming CIS team, primarily. I believe they are from Ukraine. But they provided a lot of upsets. A lot of upsets lately. So they've beaten a lot of the, like, they got a pretty solid lockdown on all the Tier 3 and Tier 2 teams. Not many issues with that, but they have recently beaten, they've actually been losing a lot more matches. Okay, so they beat Vega and Moscow 5. I remember those two matches. Those two, I was like, oh, Jesus, they beat, like, some of the better Tier 2 CIS teams. That's kind of surprising. And I guess really that's all they've beaten. I thought they did better than that. Maybe we're missing some matches. Anyway, those two were just best of one, so maybe not. It beat Game Online, Goomba, Next. Yeah, Next is a pretty decent team. Remaining. They beat them in a best of three, so that's something. Anyway, they're kind of one of those remaining CIS teams that you may need to look out for, as they have been.
Reserve time.
They've been doing quite well for themselves in the Tier 3 area. We'll see up against Team Alternate, a team that is also from that kind of Tier 3 category, hasn't really been able to provide that much hype for themselves, seeing as they're pretty solidly stuck in the Tier 3 area. But they just beat 4ASC. They are an all-Polish team, led by Nisha and Exotic Deer, two of the names that you probably recognize the most. They've beaten Balkan Bears Corleone. They have beaten
10 seconds.
Yeah, that's pretty much
remaining.
It. They beat Balkan Bears and they beat 4ASC to be here. That's about it.
5 seconds remaining.
Anyway, Chen, Dragonite, and Rubik picked up by Scary Faces as they are going to be going heavy into a push lineup here. Team Alternate are going to be taking the Beastmaster, Skywrath Mage, and Crystal Maiden that is going to be able to give them an equal amount of fighting power, I would say. It doesn't necessarily give you that much push. The Beastmaster gives you a little bit, but not that much just yet. But it is something to look out for. Second set of bans, Broodmother and Lone Druid banned away by Scary Faces, the heavy split pusher. Scary Faces is going to be focusing on a lot of 5-man pushing and do not want to deal with those heavy split pushing heroes, Spirit while Breaker. Team Alternate will take away some of the better... Well, one of them being a core, the Leshrac, who's another really great team fighter and pusher. And then they'll also ban away the Visage, who is could have been run as a 4-position support instead of the Rubik, who's going to be taking over a 5-position. We're probably going to be seeing the Chen go all in on the mech and Aghanims. Spirit Breaker picked up by Scary Faces gives them... he's got a lot of heroes he can lock down pretty well. The Skywrath Mage and Crystal Maiden, two supports that are super susceptible to physical damage as they start out with a huge lack of armor. They don't really have a whole lot of ways to defend themselves. Like, Skywrath Mage is decently fast movement speed-wise, but he's got no armor. And Crystal Maiden, who's got a little bit of armor, is super-duper slow. So these heroes are going to be just food for the Spirit Breaker, as I see it. If he has a decent laning phase, but we'll see whether or not that actually happens. S- Slark going to be picked up by Team Alternate. So this now gives them a little bit, like this gives them a better carry than anything that Scary Faces has right now. He's dealing with a lot of tanky heroes, so the kind of sustained damage and buildup from the Slark is usually pretty favorable against kind of tanky heroes like this. But at the same time, if you're not careful, you're susceptible to not being able to dish out nearly enough damage and lose to mid-game pushes. So that is something that it's got to be a little bit worrying. For the, there we go. Fixed it. It's got to be something a little bit worrying for Team Alternate. They do have some spam through primarily through the Crystal Main with the Crystal Nova as well as the Beastmaster Axis. So that will give them something to help mitigate some of these pushes, but I do anticipate Scary Faces to be able to take control of this game. The Tier 2 ones and Tier 2 towers by like 25-30 minutes and look to push uphill by 35. But of course, a lot of this depends on what their hard carry is going to be here. What's really left? Aluna is a possibility as a nice pushing hero that we've seen a lot in the current meta, but I don't think that... I don't know. Maybe it's a little bit too squishy versus Beastmaster and Slark. The Beastmaster lockdown is pretty tough for Luna to deal with. Team Alternate... they go along the same line of thought. They just decide that Luna is enough of a viable threat. They don't want to give Scary Faces that kind of extra pushing carry. But what's really left? The Gyrocopter and Luna are both down. The Leshrac is taken away. The Lone Druid was banned out.
10 seconds remaining.
There really aren't that many pushing carries left that I can think of.
Reserve time.
Now I'm just getting through hard carries. Huskar! What? All right, that was not what I was expecting. I don't know if you can call it a pushing carry, but it's got really great synergy with both the Dragonite and the Spirit Breaker, and that he's going to be able to give off that regeneration to both of these strength heroes. The, Inner Vitality is the name. Been so long since I've casted a Huskar game. I forgot the name of the ability for a second. Inner Vitality is actually based on your HP. So if you have very tanky heroes, Inner Vitality can be used for not only him, but also for some of your allies. Dragonite and Spirit Breaker are going to be able to get a huge boon out of that heal. It's already hard enough to kill the Dragonite as is.
Prepare for battle.
Oh, look at that shiny new mask. Inscribed Searing Dominator. Thing's pretty badass. It's really distracting, but it's super badass. All right, Sasu going to be starting off here. He's going to go for the double boar strategy, most likely. Most Beastmasters do in the offlane. He will be facing up against a defensive tri lane of Scary Faces, which should be Rubick, Huskar, and, of course, the Chen, able to make rotations here and there. Team Alternate are going to be running an Invoker mid up against the Dragonite, and then we have a defensive tri lane of Crystal Maiden, Skyrath Mage, and Slark going up against the offlane Spirit Breaker. All things considered, I would say that Spirit Breaker should be able to survive in this lane. Beastmaster, a little bit more dangerous for him, I would say. He doesn't have an obvious escape mechanism against a heavy damage-dealing hero like Huskar. He's pretty susceptible to that. And the best part of this is Rubick and Chen can go ahead and smoke gank together and rotate around the map. And Huskar can pretty much solo zone out the Beastmaster once he's got a level and gold advantage. So Bounty Runes picked up, one for the Dragonite, one for the Invoker. Pretty standard stuff. Now, the Dragonite has gotten some recent buffs. We'll talk about that. The 6.84, and this is very important for the laning phase. Dragonite got a buff to breathe fire. So now when he spams it out, it actually decreases the attack damage of the heroes that it hits. So 20% damage reduction at level 1. Remember that when the Tidehunter was picked up, stages took so much damage from that one. Supreme, really good read. Just continuing to harass out the Dragonite, who was so concerned that he would lose his right click. As it is, he's missing a lot already. Rotation out, Frostbite goes down. They may actually be able to get this kill. The bottle comes in just in time, and Dragonite should survive. In fact, they're going to be able to get the kill on the Invoker at the same time. First Blood goes the way with the Satyr Tormentor, able to get that kill. And State will actually be able to stay in lane because of that. So the Chen making the right rotation with the Satyr actually gets the turnaround kill there after State was so low. Crystal Maiden coming in. Dragonite, maybe he'll die this time around. Slowing him down, but the Frostbite isn't good enough, and the Satyr's going to be able to almost finish off the Crystal Maiden. The rotation, Spirit Breaker's going to be able to get that kill. Team Alternate off to a very bad start as Scary Face is finding all the right openings. Chen, you could say, has had a very huge impact in this game already. Oh, don't forget about the summon units change. This should apply to the Chen, but when he got the last hit on the Invoker and got the kill through his Satyr, he should have been able to get that now. They said summon units, but I'm going to presume that Chen and Enchantress creeps follow that line of logic as well. You guys can certainly let me know if I am totally off base with that, but judging from the Chen's experience and how much time he was spent ganking and not farming, I think he got to jump up. Man, this lane's going to be getting so dangerous for the Beastmaster once level 6 is up. I mean, it's already scary enough for just Telekinesis. Certainly one of those lanes he's probably going to need a TP scroll against.
Nay.
Uh-oh. State? He's got a Haste Rune, so he should be fine. In fact, he's going to try and win this man fight, but with the Forge Spirit there, it's not a fight he can really win too easily. He was trying to make a bit of an outplay there, but wasn't going to happen. He's still got another stun, but the Crystal Maiden is here protecting the Invoker. I doubt he'll try and get too offensive. Quas regen already kicking into play. Dragonite is going to take some damage from the Frostbite here. She's got to be careful, though. Hasted Dragonite not to be messed with, that's for sure. So CS-wise, things are looking pretty good for Scary Faces. They've got three heroes up in the top 5. Both offlaners are being shut out pretty extensively, so this gives even more advantage to Scary Faces who have that kind of jungle. Invisibility pop from the Dragonite with the smoke gank as well, but Supreme is actually just jungling. Dragonite's having a rough time getting last hits. Invoker shows up now, but it's a bit too late. The Chen has already abandoned his smoke gank. We'll be backing up. So offlaners, comparison-wise, Spirit Breaker slightly ahead in experience, but not by too much. Gank here on the Dragonite. They're going to be able to get this kill. Sunstrike, not even needed. The Invoker gets the right clicks anyway. So the Chen smoke gank guy just came too early, it seems. Level 5 almost complete for the Husk. And if
Rubik wants to, he could probably just leave a laning ward like he's got one now and just rotate out of lane. If he wants to go and heavily gank or maybe double pull, like, he can do whatever he wants at that point in time and just leave the Huss solo against that underleveled Beastmaster. Charge through. Looks like they're going to go for the middle Invoker, who's already being brought low by Chen and Dragonite. They do have the Nux to be able to finish him off. A regeneration rune actually going to be found. That's going to be very nice for the Dragonite to have.
Structures are fortified.
He's going to expend the rest of his mana here, use bottle.
Bottom tower is under attack.
Just try and get as much pushing time on that tower as possible with this gank. And I'm sure he'll go get the regeneration a little bit later. Zonic Deer is going for a Midas first build. Has it by 6.5 minutes. Not too bad. Beastmaster still struggling to find any openings here. He does have a stack, an ancient stack, that he can farm up a bit later. But for now... Charge going out middle lane. They're actually going on the Dragonite. The Sunstrike will miss, and this will allow the Dragonite to easily live. He's going to pop the Regeneration Rune, has the stun, stuns up the Invoker. Meanwhile, they have the Spirit Breaker stunning up the Crystal Maiden, easily being able to burst down those two heroes. And there's Skywrath Mage, abandoned ship. As well he should. That was a terrible fight for them.
Dire's bottom tower.
Exotic Deer in the meanwhile, well, he's got to push in this Tier 1 tower as best he can. With a loss like that, he needs to be able to find some other openings.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Uh-oh, charge, Nisha. I don't think he expected this one. Spearbreaker, if he gets a bash. No, he doesn't go for the secondary hit. Instead, he's just trying to get out ahead of this one. The Sunstrike will be on the mark, and it looks like the magic damage is just not going to be enough. 8 HP, damn. That is very unfortunate. There's nothing like the Beastmaster Bounty Rune call.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
I have no idea what sound that is supposed to be.
Radiant's middle tower.
Slark gets a tier 1 tower at bottom. They deny the middle tower. Things, I mean, just tower-wise are going well for Team Alternate, even if they are losing some kills.
Dire's bottom tower is
a level 7 husk. Not even the boar can really come forward in CS. It just dies too quickly.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Looks like they'll take this tower, but Dragonite pops the ultimate. They know that it's very
Radiant
unlikely Alternate try
fortified.
And contest them for this one. It's an offlane tower. Who really cares?
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Bottom lane, Spiritbreaker charges out of the Slark. This is why I said that I feel like the Spiritbreaker shouldn't really die. In this lane, he's going to pop the ultimate, tries to get off, but the silence is there from Nisha and manages to get the kill on the Spiritbreaker. Good recovery.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified. Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Frostbite on Dragonite, but he's still got plenty of charges, and he really wants this tower. He gets another pot shot off onto the tower, which will actually drop below deny range thanks to the poison. That's a bit unfortunate. The charge, Spiritbreaker actually pops the ultimate here. Supreme does not have his Ghost Walk up, and he will be dying. Pure damage out from Sunstrike isn't enough to get the kill on the Huskar. And he claims another one. We'll soon have an armlet. In fact, he has it already.
Radiant's top tower has been denied.
Gold for me.
Thank you. push out here. Dragonite's got an Ogre Club, and they also have the Armlet up on the Huskar. So they can probably just two or three man into towers, feeling pretty confident that if alternate do contest, they can make trade-offs. They do have the Chen heal in the back as well. Oh, actually, they don't have the Chen heal yet. Not quite level 6. Gotta remember, his jungle was slowed down pretty heavily by his rotations, primarily his first, like, 2.5 minutes were using the Satyr in that middle lane.
Radiant's bottom tower has fallen.
So this isn't your typical, like, all-in farming Chen. Now, he's still got a decent amount of gold, though, and that's primarily thanks to the towers that are dropping
Dire's
like flies. He's
already
got a mech plus another 700 gold, so he can get boots if he wants to, or he may end up going for the all-in,
Radiant's bottom tower
all
is
in
under attack.
Just like raw stats. But with Guardian Greaves, it's just too unlikely. I mean, Guardian Greaves is such a strong item in the, Well, they hold in the Crystal Main, but Exotic Tier is sitting here on the side waiting for his jump. They're
going to
lose the Tier 2 tower. The TP back from Dragonite is stopped. Cold Snap goes down. Now they're going to be able to make use of this one. Miss pounce. Dragonite gets some damage out. And looks like he will be abandoned by some of his allies. Huskar's here. He's going to go on Exotic Deer, who's still got his ultimate. Pops the Dark Pact and is able to get away. Gets low, though, as that burn damage just brought him so damn close to death. But Sasu is going to be the turnaround kill. Whoa, Quista almost killed himself there, but manages to survive. That was a bit awkward. Tier 1 tower, or Tier 2 tower, will end up being denied. So he'll be fine. Anyway, I was expecting a little bit of damage to come out on the Huskar as he dropped that armlet, but he felt way more confident than I did, I guess. So they lose the Dragonite, but they get Dire's the Slark. The Tier 2 tower falls, attack. Even if it is a deny. Not a clear victory for Scary Faces, but one that goes slightly in their favor, I would say. And out with the room that they've actually bought themselves, being able to now go for Roshan. The power of Huskar. Dropping that HP lower and lower through Armlet of Mordigan, as well as the Burning Spears, allowing him to attack faster and faster, is actually becoming a very strong damage dealer. Do they have enough damage, though? Oh, Jesus, Husk. Armlet toggle. He'll be good. Almost died there. As long as he doesn't get bashed at the wrong time, that'll be fine. So there it is. Aegis now picked up on the Huskar, so he can just freely YOLO on in. Sasu and Nisha gonna be able to find a pick off on the Dragonite, but do they have enough damage? Lock him down with the Mystic Flare. Should be enough to Sunstrike on top. Yeah, that'll definitely be enough. Just the two of them, it was gonna be like, okay, you're not gonna bring him down with just the combination. And you could definitely see that where he almost survived to get out of the Mystic Flare. But with the Sunstrike added on top, that extra 287 pure damage definitely makes a big difference. The Exotic Deer, he's going to add the Shadow Blade soon. Of course, Slark's no longer building into Blink Daggers, really, because the Shadow Blade allows you to, of course, build into the Silver's Edge through the Sange. And it's just such a valuable item, seeing as the break mechanic is so unique now to Dota, with the with Hexes no longer providing break. That it now means that not only was Silver's Edge already a great item, but the break mechanic being so unique, it's going to set up a lot, especially for heroes like Dragonite, for example. His 12 armor from Dragonblood completely gone with that break mechanic. The Spirit Breaker, technically his Bash and Empowering Haste, I guess, get taken away. And, of course, Berserker's Blood out from the Huskar. So there's a lot of big passives to take away. Tier 2 tower is going to fall. They're going to try and make a trade-off. Exotic Deer going for the Tier 2 tower push at bottom lane.
Radiant's middle tower is under
They're
attack.
Just trying to slow down the mid lane push as best as possible.
But they're not going to get it, I think. The TP's back, should be able to catch him. In fact, the Exotic Deer is going to TP back just ahead of the Spirit Breaker. They're going to be able to catch the Skywrath Mage, meanwhile, in middle lane. Spirit Breaker, unfortunately, lost his target as the TP back to base, and he canceled it, putting himself on the cliff. Not sure why. Now the rest of his allies are still fighting. They're still going to go for this Tier 3 tower. No one can deal with this Huskar. He's got Mech behind him. He's got the Chen heal. Spirit Breaker actually comes in the side. Exotic Deer takes some damage. They managed to get the telekinesis hold on him, but the rest of the team didn't follow up those disables. And Exotic Deer will get away. Sasu, not quite as lucky, though. The Huskar is dropping low, but it just means he'll dish out more damage as soon as he sees. Exotic Deer hits the pounce on himself. There goes Aegis. Life number one down for the Huskar. Oh, man, that damage was just enough to be able to finish off the Slark there. Didn't think it would. Buyback out from him, and Scary Faces should be happy with the way that engagement went. They got a Tier 3 tower. They got a couple of kills. They just need to back themselves up. They have a very dominant showing here in the first 15 minutes of the game. As long as they don't throw that away by trying to push uphill too early or too eagerly. I see that they should be able to walk away with a victory here. Armlet, BKB for the Hus coming up soon. Now, the old meta would have said, you wouldn't have seen Tier 3 towers drop by 16 minutes, no matter how well the game was going for one team or another. But in the old meta, you would have seen teams base their whole entire pushes around Roshan. Not sure if this is going to be the same here. Huskar is going to end up going down. Good pickoff from the Polish squad.
What does that make you?
Running with the pack.
That'll delay up that BKB, which is pretty important. A Shadow Blade from Exotic Deer. They're going to be able to get this tower. They're going to bring it down into deny range at the very least. State tries to go for the deny, but unable to get there. Now actually pops his BKB. He wants to turn and fight this one with the Chen coming in from the side. Maybe they can with his engagement. But Elisha able to get off a good ultimate, but that's not good enough. The Spirit Breaker will put a stop to it. Beastmaster getting away.
Quick sprint.
Ramses, he just wants to be able to pop this ultimate. Nisha trying to get out. Will be able to thanks to that cover tornado from Supreme. Nicely played. Meanwhile, Exotic Deer does manage to get the Chen. The Rubick stole the ultimate, though. Will be able to pop Exotic Deer. Big play from our Rubick. So, yeah, he got a kill on the Chen, but is now down for 60 seconds with the Dragonite, who already popped his ultimate to start that fight off. Means that he can actually push uphill, knowing that the Slark does not have a buyback. As long as he doesn't do it too far ahead of his allies. Spirit Breaker's coming in with the charge. He's going to be able to bump back Supreme. He's still got his ultimate at even and will be able to lock him down with the Dragonite stun as well. Supreme gets off a tornado, buying some distance, but the zap from Egnard is enough to finish him off. They brought the Dragonite low, though, and that will stop his push. The rest of the allies of Scary Faces are on the retreat. Rubick, well, he just got his Glimmering Cape and will TP out with that one. Very nicely played. Man, Egnard.
Regeneration.
This guy is proven to be one hell of a player. Still, though, the rest of Scary Faces, net worth-wise, meet the Beastmaster. The Chen, who is at the bottom of Scary Faces, is above the Beastmaster, Skywrath Mage, and the Crystal Maiden. Guardian Greaves, how much, I forget how much gold it is for the...
That should help.
For the recipe, 1650. So, and another 700 gold, he will have... the big team fight item. We do have another smoke up, though, from Team Alternate. They want to find something. And they'll see the Spirit Breaker, but not that by itself. They actually want to get the Rubick, but Glimmering Cape is already being laid down. And just that little bit of an interrupt is enough to make things go bad for the Poles, as Team Alternate going to lose their two supports. Exotic Deer manages to get himself away. 7-19 to the favor of Scary Faces. BKB for Dragonite, BKB for Husk. Husk, this is his first BKB charge. Second one for the Dragonite. And our Spirit Breaker. Well, there's something got to be flying in. No? Okay. So our Spirit Breaker doesn't have nearly as much farm. Oh, he invested into the Midas. So that makes sense. Medallion and Urden are not too bad. If he actually gets the full Solar Crest, it's going to be amazingly strong with the Huskar, whose biggest fear, obviously, is going to be physical damage, but the Solar Crest giving you that increase in armor and evasion. Be critical to the survival of this Huskar. At low HP. 7 to 19, the range rack is already down. Scary Faces now focusing that next round. Charge in, Sasu going to be hit. They're going to drop the ultimate Mystic Flare, but the Rubik actually turns around and gets the ultimate onto Sasu, almost finishing him off. Crystal Maine will end up going down, two out already, and a third back to base. This means the melee racks will easily fall. Scary Faces do not drop a single hero and will move on to take the tier 3 tower at the bottom lane as well. The Slark still not having buyback just due to time. Minute and a half for him. The harassment is coming in. Huskar taking a bit of damage from these Forge Spirits. But actually pops BKB. Now will turn to finish off Sasu and get in the enemy's face. Bump back, hits two. Ramses needs to be able to get out though. They lost their Huskar. And now with the Crystal Maine here, they may lose even more. The sendback on the Spirit Breaker is enough to get him away. Eknart also going to TP out. No, the Frostbite stops him just in time. Eknart will not make the clever escape that he did last time. And they'll be able to get the Chen as well. So a bit of greed there for Scary Faces as they try to push in and get a second Tier 3 tower. But end up getting caught in the process. Feeding back some gold to Team Alternate. A good amount too. Almost 3K gold. 4K experience. Still though, Scary Faces well enough ahead that they can probably... Oh dear. Yeah, embrace your death, Crystal Maine. You are very, very screwed.
Ran you down.
Anyway, Scary Face is still super far ahead for 22 and a half minutes. And should be able to get Roshan. I think that if ATN leave up Roche for Scary Faces to take, they automatically lose the game. That was weird. Necrobook 2 for the Beastmaster, Necrobook 3 for the Invoker, and there it is. This item so critical to the Slark for this match. It is good against every single one of the cores of Scary Faces, but particularly that Huskar.
Dire's top tower is under.
He's going to go for the Tier 2 here, but Spirit Breaker is already charging him. Will not be able to claim that tower. Ultimate pop, TP out. No AoE stuns from the side of Scary Faces. Ooh, double damage. That'll help them do Roshan a whole lot faster, especially since Huskar, really, he's just missing damage. He's got plenty of attack speed, great survivability. The only thing he's missing is damage to be able to quickly take Roshan. And that TD will provide everything he needs. And with this Aegis, I really don't see how ATN are going to be able to deal with the next push of Scary Faces. They've already lost one set of racks. They cannot afford to lose a second set.
Roshan has fallen to the Dire.
We'll see. The push is going to come through the bottom lane. Oh. Ramsey, you just keep doing this to yourself, buddy.
Quick sprint.
I mean, I guess it works. But he's obviously keeping the top lane pushed and can join his ally. Not immediately, but through charge. Oh, he's going to stop the TP! Oh, Ramses! You clever dog, you! And he can actually get back to he can actually get to bottom lane, potentially, before the Slark even does. With his next charge up, but Just the Slark being away is going to allow the Huskar to easily go uphill without much fear. Telekinesis is going to be able to stun up Sasu. Eknard is going to get blown up at the same time. They're caught outside of the base. Nisha's already dead. Exotic Deer is here, but unable to do much about it. The charge through, going to be able to hit the Crystal Maiden, actually top the ultimate onto Supreme instead, but his allies are not close enough to be able to take advantage of that. State now charges forward, going for that Invoker. He's going to be able to get this kill, a couple of right clicks, and does. Now turns on Sasu. Twisted, meanwhile, fighting up against Exotic Deer. The charge onto him, manages to pounce himself away, but the damage over time is enough to get the kill. Buyback out from him, but he's the only one who can do so, and there's no way he can take on the side of Scary Faces 1v4. He may try, but it's going to be a losing endeavor. 1v5, if you want to include the Huskar, who actually has an Aegis. So instead of going for the third set of racks here, they're just going to go straight for Tier 4. Not sure what our Slark is going for. He's killing his items. All right. That is, that's classic. That's a classic right there. What a play. Anyway, so we should see ATN probably GG out. As it's pretty much a waste of everyone's time if you don't GG out at this point. I know a lot of people like to flame. Oh, you can't say that. They can always come back and that sort of thing. And that's fine. Yes, they can absolutely always come back unless one of your allies is actually killing his items. That's not a thing. That's not a thing. So, GG, well played. And our first semifinal ends with Scary Faces, a dominating report Slark. Thanks. Oh, boy. You almost gotta wonder if this, Oh, look at that GG. You almost gotta wonder if this team is gonna survive with a game like that and the reactions of some of his allies. But either way, Scary Faces will move on to the finals, and we will be seeing our next semifinals, Basically Unknown, facing up against, I already lost the name of the team, Zero Respect. That's right, it was the French team that managed to beat Balkan Bears Corleone. Should be an interesting match, to say the least, so we're going to take a short break, and we'll be back.